Christ. It's so good to be with you on this third Sunday in November. It's not quite as cold outside. There's always fire inside the church of Jesus Christ. I want to remind you that there will be breakfast served between the services this morning. So in the fellowship hall right after service, breakfast is going to be served. Also, this afternoon at 4 o'clock, we're going to have a special time of Thanksgiving as we celebrate with the Methodist men the annual Thanksgiving concert. So we invite you to come back. We're going to take an offering during that service, and the offering is going to be non-perishable foods to be given to our food pantry so that we can resupply it and make sure we have enough food for those who are in need during this holiday season. So please come, participate, bring your non-perishable goods so we can supply the world with all kinds of bounty. Now this morning we're going to pray also as we continue to pray for Dwayne and his family and their loss of the past few weeks of his grandmother and his mother. But if there are others we need to be in prayer for, I invite you also to name them, that we can be in prayer together this morning for the sake of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Do you have other names you wish to share, other situations you want to lift up this morning?
I just want to thank everyone that's here for all the cards and condolences that you have given me for the past three deaths that was in our family. Prior to that, before my grandmother died, the week before that, my uncle died. So we went through a big battle in South Carolina, and so I thank you all for the condolences and letters and well wishes that you have given out to our family. Thank you.
Are there any others? Let's pray to God. Almighty God, gracious, forgiving. Your eye is ever upon us, and your love is poured out so richly that our cups overflow each and every day. We ask you now, Lord, hear us in our petitions, hear us in our prayers. Wash over us with your Holy Spirit that we might be able to praise you in spirit and in truth and to spread a good word and tell good news in a world that's so full of troubling indications. Move us to go from this church today to be witnesses of your glory so that all may see and know that you are real and that you live and you live in us and that this is finally your world. Help us to be compassionate toward those who are hurting today. Help us to bring truth to a world where truth can hardly be found. Help us to stand up for what is just and right, so that all may know that they are loved and cared for and will be heard, and that they too can be a part of our great family. These are the things we pray for today. In your name's sake, amen. Well, as always, it's so good to see everybody who is here on Sunday morning. I just appreciate you every time that you come out. I enjoy seeing you and be with you on every Sunday when we're able to praise the Lord together. Now, do we have any first-time guests here at St. Matthew's Church? If you are, you don't mind standing, we'd like to see you and just pour a whole lot of God's love into your life. Do we have any first-time guests this morning? Yeah, now that we have two students, they're international students at UNCG. It's good to have them here with us this morning. Thank y'all for coming. Are there others this morning? I don't think I see anybody else. All right, how about we all stand, greet one another, pour some love into somebody's life, and tell them how good it is to be alive this morning.
Come on, how you doing?
That's all. I'm so good to see you today.
Thank you. You have a unique gift that is yours alone. It is something that you love to do and are able to do well. That is called your talent. You may have more than one. Your talent or shapes, your talent or talents shape your life. Jesus tells a story in the Bible about three people who were given an amount of money. Two of the people used their money well, and they made an increase while the other person hid their money in a hole in the ground where it did no good and did not increase. This story teaches us the importance of using what we have, our gifts or talents, so that what we have will increase and be a blessing to others. Your talent may be that you're kind and helpful, or that you have a strong body and excel at sports, or that you love animals and are good at caring for them. There are endless choices. Can someone tell me what their talent is? Anyone
want
to share there? What's your talent? Your talent. Great. Any others? Flipping. Darren loves to flip. That's his talent. Your life is shaped by your talents and how you use them. Choose well and bless others with your gifts. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for today and every day. We know that you don't want us to hide our light from the world. Help and guide us this week as we work to spread your love to others. Amen. My kiddos, we also have Sunday school this morning right after breakfast, so join us in the nursery right after you eat. Thanks.
Bibles are available, and it's on page 919, Luke 23, starting with verse 32. Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place which is called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and one on the left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by, watching, but the ruler scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him vinegar, and saying, "If you are the King of Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentences of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingly power." And he said to him, "Truly I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
one that we tackled before. We looked at this scripture in some detail in the Lenten Easter season of last year. I want to look at it again as we consider what it means to be witnesses for the glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and what the power of our witnesses can be, even when it seems that our time has run out. Won't you pray with me? Lord, give our voices power and strength. Give our hearts courage. Inspire our minds that you might be able to have your own way. You are the potter and we are your clay. Amen. From the very creation of humankind, God's grace has washed over us. God's forgiveness has been with us. And new life has been offered to us every moment of every day. This was affirmed when Cain killed Abel, and God mocked Cain not to curse him, but to say that others should not hurt. It is also the affirmation that God gives from the cross in Jesus Christ in these simple words, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Those simple words lay the foundation that says that God's forgiveness is plentiful, is offered freely, and if you choose to receive God's forgiveness, you shall walk with God in paradise. Now, we have set the scene here. It was the time of the crucifixion. Jesus was on the cross, and there were two men who were hung beside him. Both were criminals who were being punished for their crimes. Jesus was on the cross. He had done no crime. He was an innocent man, yet he was dying all the same. And these two men had very different responses to what was happening on that fateful day. The soldiers were casting lots for his clothes. Others were looking and vilifying him and what was going on. And one of the criminals from the cross shouted out, "Hey, you saved everybody else. Why don't you save yourself and save us too?" And the other criminal, who was just as guilty as the first, said, "Shut up, man. Don't you realize who he is? Don't you realize what's going on? This man has done nothing wrong. You and I are paying the price for our crimes. But this man has done nothing wrong, and here he is beside us." And then he said, "Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, will you just remember me?" And that shows what the true power of forgiveness is really all about. The true power of forgiveness is being remembered for the best of who you are, even when you're suffering for the worst of what you've done. Forgiveness means, will you remember the best of who I am? Will you remember me when you love me well and you like me for who I was? Will you remember me and give me the hope to become something brand new? Will you forgive me of all my sin? Can you remember who you dreamed that I could be? Can we move on in a new kind of relationship? Can you remember what it was like to love me? And love me like that one more time. Even if you had to love me differently, can you love me all over again? Will you remember me? Maybe he heard Jesus when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are." Maybe he was laying his hope on those last words. Remember me even though I have to pay a price right now. Remember me even though I have to die right now. Remember me even though I lived my life in a way that did not represent the best of who I was and did not honor the God that created me. But still remember me. And that's was offered to us. That memory, that hope that will not disappear, that love that will not go away, but we have to learn to trust that love. And as we trust that love, accept that even though we have to pay the consequence for what we have done, paying that consequence does not erase God's forgiveness. You see, forgiveness has two parts to it. We talked about this last week, but there's another part we got to talk about too in a little bit more detail. Even though we are forgiven for what we have done, there is still consequence of what we have done. Y'all with me? Even though we are forgiven for our sin has still affected other people in ways that may have brought hurt, harm, and danger to their lives. That is not erased when we are forgiven. The consequences still go on and on and on until family history puts them in the background. But we just can't say all is forgiven and forgotten because we don't forget very well, do we? As human beings, we carry mess for years, for generations after generation. We remember our hurts so well that if those hurts were just as real a day as when it first happened, as a matter of fact, we amplify the hurts, don't we? As time goes by and the more we hold on to them, the bigger the hurt gets. The worse the action is. Because somehow we start adding things to it because we can't hold on to hurt and then we start adding stuff to it. Now part of that is because sometimes we're not given the opportunity to express the hurt right now. Sometimes people don't give the room for us to say, this happened, it hurt me, it tore my life, and I want somebody to hear. And when that happens, when things get pushed down like that, when they come out with power. They come out with some power that make folks scared. But everything eventually comes out. But when it does, when the consequence is there, and if we have ourselves face to face with what is real and what we've done, can we trust at that moment that God has not forgotten us, that God remembers us? When the things come out that we tried to hide and put down and put out, can we still trust that in the revelation, there is a greater revelation waiting to be? Can we hear those words that says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do? And even as we pay the price, can we trust that the price we pay does not erase the image of God that lives within us? If we can make that trust, then we can stand up. We can confess our sins. And having confessed our sins, we can stand in the midst of that confession and let the world do what the world must do, trusting that God will do so much more. We can lose everything in the world because we begin to gain everything in God. Two men were losing their lives for their crimes. That was not going to change. They were going to pay the price for their sins. That was not going to change. But one man became bitter and he became accusatory and he wanted to get out of it the best way he knew. He wanted to do the blame on somebody else. He said, it's not my fault, Lord, it's your fault. I've done stuff, but I'm here dying. But you saved other people. Why don't you save yourself and save me too? If you wanted to, you could take money from me. If you wanted to, you can get me off this cross, but you're not going to do it. So God, I'm going to blame you for everything you ever do in life. Blame. Obfuscation. Make things cloud. Misdirection. Have all the attention on somebody else. So my stuff don't seem quite as bad. I want to be remembered for my shouting and my anger and my
He said, Lord, just remember me in your kingdom. Lord, here I am, a sinner. Here I am, convicted. Here I am, dying. I can't change any of that right now. And I'm not going to try to blame anybody else for it. It was me, and I did it, and here I am. But as I am, remember me. As I am, till the last moment. As I am, in these last moments of my life, can you hold a memory of me that is something better than what can be seen on this cross? Don't we want that too? When we messed up, when we've not lived up to what other people think we ought to be, when we've forgotten folk we should have remembered, when we've hurt folk we should have helped, when we ignored folk in they suffered from, don't we want to say, remember me, love me, forgive me, uplift me, bring me to a better place than what I deserve. Your grace has been promised, and forgiveness has been offered. This is now my witness. I tried it by myself, and I couldn't make it happen. The good I wanted to do, I did not, and the harm I didn't want to do, I did continually. Oh, but lift me something better. And when it seems that I'm losing everything, and rightly so because of what I've done, remember me. Let me begin again in you. Let new life be mine. And you know the promise. And you heard the words of Jesus. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Forgiveness is the entryway. Confession paves the way. Acceptance makes everything brand new. And that's what the cross is all about. You know, we say there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. Well, on that cross, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Will I shout and rail and blame and overt and covert and devert and do every kind of verb I can? Or from that cross, will I remember the words of my Savior? You are forgiven. Be with me in paradise today. All of us, will suffer consequences for our sin. Some of us already have, some of us yet to come. But out of the consequence, out of the grace of God, new life begins. So we Christians have mercy on one another, because none of us are clean. Now, y'all know that, right? None of us are clean. We all come to church drenched in sin. I know you put on your Sunday, go to meeting clothes. Get your best stuff, only smelling good. But that can't cover up the mess we've done from day to day. But when we step through those doors, we remember that there is a Savior out there. Someone who from the cross has claimed you are forgiven. Claim that forgiveness. Tell the story of how God changed your life. Be a witness to the world that is so lost that they can't find their way straight back home. Be the way for them. Point to that way. Be a vanguard that goes before them and let them know no matter how difficult it gets, as the song says, for every mountain that God has brought me over. For every trial, God has seen me through. I give my God all the praise. Because he has not forgotten about me.
Thank you, God.
Amen. We're going to open the doors of our church right now so that we can receive anybody who wants that relationship with Jesus Christ that offers new life. That forgiveness that says that the world does not have a final say over you and who you are, but that God remembers you for who God made you to be. If there are any this day who want that kind of relationship, who wants that in life, we're open now to receive.
I've been hearing this song since I've been in the service. I heard it from the time I came in here this morning. And it fits so well with your sermon. Because he lives, we can face him. Because he lives, all I need is. It's because he lives. Do you mind if I just sing this a little bit?
That's your testimony.
Yes.
Thank you.
4 o'clock this afternoon, I met this man's Thanksgiving concert. I had to come and bring their non-perishable goods for our food pantry so we can distribute those to those who are in need. And now may God create it in you, or create in you, a witness that is so strong and powerful that the storms and arrows of the world can't bring it down. That moves through and inspires, encourages, and uplifts those who are brokenhearted, finds those who are lost, and brings them home to the one we call Savior. And in that work, even though sometimes it may be hard, and you're not sure you can do it all by yourself, may you lean on the power of God and be renewed every day. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen, amen, and amen.